Okay, so today's lecture is on monetary policy and fiscal policy. As with other lectures, I'll simply follow the curriculum. First, the very basics. And I think this is very well expressed in the curriculum, so I'll simply read this with you. Monetary policy refers to central bank activities that are directed towards influencing the quantity of money and credit in an economy. All this is saying is core point with monetary policy is where central banks decide how much money to put into the economy. And there's a very close relationship, as you'll see, between the amount of money that is put in the economy and interest rates. Interest rates then determine the amount of credit in the society. When interest rates are high, credit is low, and vice versa. By contrast, fiscal policy refers to the government's decisions about taxation and spending. Okay, so we'll see this in a lot more detail. Both monetary and fiscal policies are used to regulate economic activity over time. They can be used to accelerate growth when an economy starts to slow, or to moderate growth and activity when an economy starts to overheat. Overheat simply means that the economy is maybe growing too fast. In addition, fiscal policy can be used to redistribute income and wealth. Okay, so if you want to tax the rich and give money to the poor, that is done through fiscal policy. Something that just you will not see too much in this reading, but to tie it to the previous reading on business cycles. So there you saw that over time, if you look at economic activity, your economic activity might be going like this. So when you see things like economy is overheating, that means that if this is your normal trend, when the economy is over here, then it's overheated. So at this point, you will see that the government is trying to hold the economy back by having a tight fiscal policy. And in terms of fiscal, by having a tight monetary policy and what's generally called a contractionary fiscal policy. These terms will come over and over. Another just general point and something you will see is central banks around the world are, their level of independence from the government varies. In Pakistan, by and large, it almost seems like the central bank is an agent of the government. That's one end of a spectrum. At another end of a spectrum, you might have a fairly independent central bank. So central banks, even though they are called central banks around the world, but their link with the government varies from country to country. Okay, so just to warm you up, to check whether you understood the basic definition, do these two questions. Okay, so based on what you've just, other things will make more sense later on in this reading, but for now one is C, because monetary policy seeks to influence the macro economy. This is the core point. Macroeconomic influences the quantity of money and credit. So this is what we just read. Okay, what about fiscal policy? Yeah, involves the use of government spending and taxation. So if you are to remember one line about monetary policy, it is this C. And if you are to know one line about fiscal policy, again, it's this last statement. But by the time you're done with this class, you will know a whole lot more than this. Okay, now let's get into the depths of monetary policy. Before we get into monetary policy, obviously, we need to understand money. And to understand money, we need to understand what would happen if there is no money. And for most of our human history, there was no money. So how did people trade? Barter trade. What's the difficulty with barter trade? For barter trade to work, you need a double coincidence of wants. Okay, so I have to find people. So if what I have to offer is CFA teaching services, so I teach you and then you bring bread or you bring whatever else. So there has to be a coincidence of wants. I have to find the people who want what I have, and those people also should have what I want. Okay, so you can imagine the inefficiency of barter trade. Okay, so money was introduced to solve that issue. There is a lot written in the curriculum, but when you look at the type of questions that are asked, I think it is better at this time to just focus on the main points and understand the definitions. So what should money do? It should be readily acceptable. So if you give me some money or I give you some money, there should not be a question as to whether any party accepts it or doesn't accept it. It should have a known value, which is obvious. Easily divisible, have a high value relative to weight. So gold could be money, but carrying that around can be, actually gold is alright. Certain other metals might have a low value relative to weight, which would just make it impractical and should be difficult to counterfeit. So basic characteristics of money. Then you also need to learn these three functions of money. Money should act as a medium of exchange, provide individuals with a way of storing wealth. So if you can keep your money, you are storing your wealth, and provide society with a convenient measure of value and unit of account. So if something is for 10 rupees and something else is for 10 rupees, you know, money is helping you figure out how much different things are worth and what is their value. As long as you learn these points on this page, I think you are fine in terms of this segment. Now, in terms of money, we've already talked about what is money, and we'll see talk about money in a little more detail, but I want to introduce this concept of what's called fractional reserve banking. What this means is, what this talks about is how money is created. Just learn this formula first and then I'll explain the logic. The amount of money created is equal to new deposits divided by reserve requirement. What's a reserve requirement? This is where banks decide, or let's say imposed by a central bank, that if a bank receives a new deposit, what are the two things that a bank can do with a new deposit? Either it can keep it or lend it out. Reserve requirement means what percentage of the money that a bank gets must it keep. So if you have a simple scenario where the reserve requirement is 10%, this means that let's say John Doe makes a $100 deposit at First Bank of Nations. If the reserve requirement is 10%, then how much money must the bank keep? The bank must keep 10 and it can loan out 90. So the balance sheet of the bank will then look something like this, where the reserves are 10. Is that an asset? Yeah. When a bank makes a loan, is the loan an asset? The loan is an asset. So the loan is 90, the reserves are 10, deposits are liabilities. So this is what the balance sheet will look like for First Bank of Nations. Then the loan was made to Mr. XYZ. What does he do? He goes and deposits that money in his account at Second Bank of Nations. Given the reserve requirement of 10%, what now happens to the balance sheet of the second bank? So the second bank must keep 9 and it can loan out 81. Alright, so and so on, this process, and then that 81 is deposited at third bank and the same process goes on. Now, if we also, when you think of your money, you have some cash with you, and then you might have 20,000 rupees in your bank account, which is the deposit that you made. Is that 20,000 rupees also, do you also think of that as your money? Yeah, so you don't think about whether that money physically exists or not, you still think of that as your money. So clearly deposits are also then part of money, because when you are counting your money for whatever reason, you are adding up all the deposit amount. So the deposit then is also money. And notice that with only $100 more cash that the first person got, how much more money did we create? Every time a deposit is made, loans are made, and then further deposits and loans happen, more money is being created. So mathematically it can be shown that with $100 that were initially deposited, the total amount of money created, given that deposits are also money, is given by this expression over here, new deposit over reserve requirement. So in this simplistic example, how much money was created? So the money created was 100 over 10 or 0.1?
0.1.
Yeah, 10%, which is 0.1. So the amount of money created was 1000. And all this is due to the fraction. This, why is this called fractional reserve banking? Because a fraction of the money deposited is actually kept as a reserve and the rest is loaned out. Let's see if you can do this now. Again, as I said, if you remember the basic definitions, this should be easy. To fulfill its role as a medium of exchange, money should, like this makes, as in, doesn't make sense, have a low value relative to weight, or it should have high value. Yeah, so that's also wrong, and can be easily divisible and a good store of value. So if you know the things from the previous page, you are fine. What about two? Your reserve requirement is 5%, how much money? So you would simply have your expression is the new deposit divided by 0.05, which is 2000. Which of the following functions does money normally fulfill for a society? Yeah, obviously this only messes things up with A, the only messes things up with B, and then C gives you all the functions that you memorized from the previous slide. When you get concerned with the volume of your economics course, how do you console yourself?
The questions.
By looking at the questions. Okay, so when you look at the questions, you realize that, okay, I just need to get the basics. So later on when you are revising this course, don't get hung up in the immense volumes of detail. You can do that after the exam. Okay, now we've already talked about money. Let's get a little deeper into definitions. I'm sure everybody here and everybody listening to this video has heard of definitions of money, and in that context they've heard of M1 and M2. And actually most economics, almost all economics textbooks that I've seen have been written by Americans. And what you read there, and perhaps what you end up thinking, is the whole world uses M1 and M2, which is not true. This M1 and M2 and the definitions that you have read are the definitions of M1 and M2 in the United States. Other countries also have different definitions of money, but in UK, for example, M2 might mean something different from M2 in the United States. And in Pakistan, it might mean something else. So you just need to be aware of that. Since you probably have studied the United States M1, M2, let's just start with that. And then you don't need to understand the subtle differences across countries. You just need to know that different countries will have slightly different definitions of money. Let's start with the US though. The US Federal Reserve produces two measures of money. The first is M1, which comprises notes and coins in circulation. So let's just write this down because you need to know this, important from a testability perspective. So it is notes and coins, traveler's checks. So that's traveler's checks and non-bank of non-bank issuers, demand deposits. So these are like our regular checking accounts, plus other deposits, so your basic deposits, and these are deposits on which check can be written. So this is the definition of M1, and this is often also referred to as a relatively narrow measure of money. M2, which is a broader measure, and in the US context it's the broadest measure. Why is it broad? Because it includes M1 plus more stuff. What's the more stuff? So notice, so M2 is M1, which is here, plus savings and money market deposits. So if you take your money and put it in a money market mutual fund, that money market mutual fund is not part of M1, but it's part of M2. So time deposits of accounts less than 100,000 plus other balances in in retail, money market and mutual funds. What's the key point? The key point is any money that is in a relatively liquid form. Just approximate rule of thumb, if you put your money in a mutual fund, it is still relatively liquid because within a day you can get access to that money. So if you can get your access, get access within a day, and it's not in an asset which is very volatile, then that would be part of your money definition. So in the US at least, this is the distinction between M1 and M2. Checks in of themselves, so if I just write a check of 20,000 to you right now, that check is sitting in your wallet. Is that part of money? No, that's not part of money. It's because if that were part of your money, that would be double counting. I have a certain deposit in my bank, you have a certain deposit in your bank. Just because the check is sitting in your wallet, that check is not impacting money. Okay, when you deposit your check, what will happen? Money will flow from my account to your account. So the simple point is that check in of itself is not money, not included in this definition of money. I might just write you a check with nothing in my account, and people do that with me sometimes, right? So then obviously that check is not money. What about a credit card with a 50,000 rupee limit? That also is not money. Okay, now we don't need to go into details here, you can read this later, but I just want to emphasize the point that in the UK you have slightly different definitions. In UK you have four sort of M's. So you have a M0, which is the narrowest measure. This is simply notes and coins held outside the Bank of England, this is their central bank, plus bankers' deposits at the Bank of England. This is the deposits that banks are making at their central bank. So this doesn't even include regular consumer deposits. M2 includes M1 plus all retail bank deposits. So M2 sounds a lot like, so England's M2 or UK's M2 sounds a lot like America's M1. Okay, how many people knew that these M1s and M2s are different across the world? Okay, some of you did, most did not. So I think a good thing about the curriculum is that they've made it much more international now. Okay. If you found this clip interesting and informative, please visit my website www.arifirfanullah.com. Here you will find a tremendous amount of useful material. Right here in the 2011 CFA video lecture series, you will find the entire level 1 curriculum for free, and most of the material here is still relevant. So this is worth looking at. The 2012 video lecture series covers both level 1 and level 2. These lectures are available for a fee. And finally, down here, financial management at IBA, here you will find my lectures at IBA for a course on financial management. Plus, you'll find lots of useful spreadsheets that can help you with financial modeling. So again, please visit www.arifirfanullah.com. Thank you.